call me San Luis Obispo. I actually started out at Fluor, which was my first job out of college, and I'm still with the company almost 29 years later. I am actually now the manager of engineering, so what that actually means, I have the final authority of engineering, so all the design disciplines, electrical, civil structural, architectural, control systems, mechanical, all those department managers and all those engineers, I am responsible for. So I'm going to let Anna just give a little bit of background about herself, and we'll give you some information about the company and just engineering in general.
Hi, my name is Anna Solis, and I am a chemical engineer, and I've been with Fluor for 23 years. I started out as what they call a process engineer, so design work. Today, I'm a project director, so now I manage all the engineers on various projects. So engineers support people and whatnot, so that's what I do. And about half my career, I traveled overseas on various projects, and we'll go through what we do as a company so you can kind of understand how we all feel.
Okay, so who is Fluor? How many have heard of our company?
A couple.
So we're in Nash Engineering Construction Company, but this is actually our headquarters in Dallas. We actually do a variety of projects. We're not limited to the refineries. When people hear energy and chemicals, they think of only oil refineries. We do power plants. We do infrastructure. One of our construction projects in Orange County was the Orange County Performing Arts Center. We're currently working on the Tappan Zee Bridge. Bay Bridge in Northern California was one of our construction projects as well. We do things in the life sciences arena. We really do a little bit of everything. So specifically for the Southern California office, we actually have two offices, even though you see three here. We're based in Long Beach as well as in San Diego. And we have project management, what we call FEED, which is front-end engineering and design. So a lot of times our clients want to know, what do we think this plant's going to look like, how much do we think it's going to cost? So they'll give us enough funding to do what we call the FEED, which is just really looking at it, trying to really get something realistic, and to do a cost estimate. Do we have enough money? But we don't actually go out and procure any equipment for them at this point in time, unless they know the project's going to go forward, and let's say it needs to be done in 2 years, but we know there's a piece of equipment that's going to take a year and a half to be built. So as you see some of the business lines we touch petroleum, gas processing, power generation, gasification, carbon dioxide recovery, infrastructure, and life sciences. So infrastructures there would be like the bridge projects. Right now we're looking at trying to do the people mover for Los Angeles. Life sciences, some of our clients would be someone like an Amgen, Bayer Healthcare, things like that. So we're very diverse. How do we get to the first video? First video I want to show, this video was put together, it's called The Day in the Life Of. And this actually was put together when we celebrated our centennial celebration. We're actually 105 years old now, but when we did our 105th celebration. That's not it. That's a fun one.
Is it engineering problem?
That's the second one. That's not that one.
Thank you.
Site offices and project offices, right? as you saw, we were in New Delhi, we were probably in China, we were in Farnborough. Actually, one of the engineers pictured in there toward the end, she's actually a Cal State Long Beach graduate.
Ooh.
And a chemical engineer. So what they did is they actually took all these snippets and they put them together. So they unveiled this at the celebration we had. And so no one knew whose video was in there and who wasn't, because they shot multiple. So, engineering skills. Coincidentally, this is National Engineers Week. What you saw was being able to work as a team. I know people think engineering, because it's so math intensive, everyone just sits at their desk and they do calculations all day. In our business, you can't do it alone. You have to work together. As Anna said, she manages a team, and it's a team that has to work together.
And sometimes a team is not necessarily in the same building or same floor. You can have a team that's across the world, and then your job site is on the other side of the world. So you have to be able to coordinate and be able to communicate with people visually, maybe also by telephone, video conference. So you try to utilize all the technology that's available to be able to communicate effectively.
And that doesn't necessarily mean that your day starts and stops at the same time. I mean, maybe once a week there's a 5 a.m. call, or it could be a 7 p.m. call. It's communicating with each other, being able to talk. I tell students when I do a lot of career fairs, they'll ask, what's most important is being able to communicate, to talk to someone, because you have to be able to convey your ideas. And, you know, really want to encourage the curiosity. Innovation is really a big thing in our company right now, especially now as you're hearing more and more about it. And we want them to ask the how and the whys, and can we do things differently, more efficiently? Just because we did it like that 5 years ago, that doesn't necessarily mean that we still continue to do it that way. It worked 5 years ago and it was probably good then. Is there a way to streamline that and make it more efficient? And just be creative and wanting to solve problems. It's just that curiosity. It's really to keep driving curiosity and to have good science and math skills. Everyone thinks engineers have to be straight A students. I'll admit, I was not a straight A student, but I had a passion for math and science, and that's really what drove me toward engineering.
So, another thing I think that's also important is that within being an engineer is, you know, being innovative. And one way many people think once they're an engineer, they think, well, I don't need to be innovative. I'll give you an example. Recently, I'm managing a project locally here in Long Beach, and we are in a refinery, and the allocated space that they gave us is very tight because it's an existing area. So imagine the size of this room, and you have a wall here, a wall there, okay? But they're full of pipes and running things, so you can't lift things over there because you got to be careful. So we're bringing in a new substation. The substation is a building, prefabricated building that contains electrical equipment that will then be able to supply power to processing units. Well, it's too big. So we have to design it such that it comes in halves. So it's going to come in two pieces. Well, it's going to come from Houston. Well, how is it going to get from Houston to Long Beach? So we have to think about the logistics of how it's going to get here. But then once it gets here, it's got to go through and exist through LA, the freeways. Then when it gets to Long Beach, to the refinery, how is it going to get through the gate? So simple things like that you may not think of. You have to be innovative. Well, now, wait a minute. So that existing road, is it going to hold the weight? Okay, once I can look at that and, yes, determine that's what it'll do, but I'll have to do some dirt work. Well, as I said earlier, we're boxed in. I can't lift a heavy load with the crane over existing pieces of pipes. How am I going to do that? Well, we thought about one way. Let's drag it under this pipe wrench. What? Drag it? Yes, and that's what we're going to do. And we modeled it. So we modeled like a high-level simulation putting in parameters, putting in information from our survey, and able to say, yes, we can drag it. We have to use some special transporters and stuff, and basically dig under the road a bit so that we can go under. But we're only about four, let's say, maybe 5 inches from hitting the top of the bridge. So we simulated that, and we were able to prove that we can do it. But then once it gets in, we have to, how are we going to lift it? So you got to put, you know, place a crane. Well, is that crane going to be big enough to be able to hold this load and make sure it doesn't fall? So you will also have to look at that. So when we looked at the crane and what type of crane you use, we also simulated the crane, well, it, our half of the building is being pulled, picked up, and then lifted and shifted over onto piers that are about 7 feet high.
How heavy was this thing?
It isn't. We're still, it's, it's about 2 tons or so.
2 tons?
Tons.
Oh.
So, but there's like, so there's two sections, but the hardest part of it is not the weight. The difficult part is getting in into a very small area.
You mean maneuvering it?
Maneuvering it inside, basically. So that calls for innovation. I mean, it sounds very simple, but you really have to think outside the box because you don't have an open area. You have to think of all these other parameters when it actually comes in because you have overhead power lines and things that you have to think about. Are you going to make those clearances when it goes on the freeway? Are you going to have clearance? You have to use the right truck. So a lot of people don't think that that's engineering, but it is.
I have a question. When you say you modeled it, did you use the software?
We used a program called SketchUp.
Oh, yeah.
I know, SketchUp, right?
Yeah.
Very simple. It was, we were able to put in information quickly and then present something very quick. And by presenting a 3D model to the client, they were like, wow, they could actually see what we were doing, rather than doing it on paper. It was just high level.
I actually have another video that I'll show you shortly that's another one, talk about innovation. But I want to draw your attention. There's the two websites we posted in the presentation, the Science Study Challenge, the Fluor Challenge there. Every year during National Engineers Week, and ironically, today was the day we Fluor globally. So this is all our offices who participate in what we call a friendly competition, or some say not so friendly. The engineers do get competitive. And so the Science Study Challenge actually takes the competition from the previous year. So the challenge for 2017 was the competition we did in 2016. And where students can go and participate in this within your schools. And within California, I believe there's at least 2 to 3 $1,000 grants if you submit the scores and everything. And so every year what they do is they take the competition we did the prior year and they, in some cases, have to simplify it. Because the one that's being done this year was a very complicated one.
So it's competition for who that becomes a challenge for high school students?
For so elementary or anyone.
What was the competition for before it became a challenge?
The friendly competition was the one we did globally within our organization for National Engineers Week. And actually, in the previous presentation where you had the rice terraces, that's what the 2017 Science Buddy Challenge is based off of, because it was actually our Philippine office that actually developed the challenge. And then also, just so you know, discovery.org has lots of activities out there, and it's free. There's no cost to it that you can go down and pick specifically what you know are interested in. Anna talked about innovation and challenges. This particular project was done for the Chevron El Segundo refinery. They have 6 existing coke drums, which I'm going to let Anna talk about the process side of it because that's not my forte. But what it is these were originally built in place. And they were, I can't remember how many years old, but they were past their life. And so Fluor was contracted, one, to help them purchase the 6 drums. Because I don't remember all the, I mean, each drum is 100 feet long by 28 feet wide, and they weigh 500,000 pounds. We purchased these drums in Spain, and we're, you know,
from Spain to the port of Los Angeles, 7,300 miles. That was the easy part of the transportation, believe it or not. It was the last 4.5 miles coming along PCH where we actually barged it into Kings Harbor and from Kings Harbor to get into the refinery. That was the most complicated portion. And it doesn't happen in the middle of the day. It happens like at midnight. And so this is one where it took everyone working with the community. Talk about having to raise power lines. They did not have to, no trees were damaged or had to be trimmed. So that was a good thing. But this was just very complicated. It was almost like an orchestra. And so that's the one, the Elsa Gunn video. You know, where Anna talked about, you know, how do we lift it, things. This was basically, this video takes something that actually took over 4 hours, the transportation from Kings Harbor to the refinery.
The boat from moving down Sepulveda on time as planned flawlessly. Last year, we transported 6 large coke guns from Spain to the port of Los Angeles.
And there we barged them to King Harbor, Redondo Beach, and then we brought them up one of those heavily trafficked corridors, Sepulveda Boulevard, Manhattan Beach, and then on Del Segundo, and into our southern entrance. We're very grateful as a refinery for the unprecedented collaboration of both the cities and the communities that worked with us to make the move. But now it's time to remove the 6 existing coke drums and replace them with 6 new coke drums here at the El Segundo Refinery.
The coker takes the bottom portion of the barrel, which we call resid, and turns it into fuels for airplanes, cars, and trucks.
The Chevron El Segundo Refinery is a very important asset for Southern California. In fact, we supply over 20% of all motor vehicle fuels and nearly half of the jet fuel at LAX. These ships are 40 years old, and in practical terms, they simply reached the end of their useful life.
In addition to replacing the drums, we made many technological improvements that make the coker facility more reliable and safer. Part of that safety is all the seismic upgrades that we did on the structure itself.
Back in the 60s, the people that had constructed this, they never thought about replacing these drums.
It took months and months for us to plan the design, rigging, the structure, everything, how we're going to get it out.
This was a huge challenge.
You know, a third option could be to remove all 6 gears simultaneously.
We decided that the most efficient and safest way was actually to lift the entire air structure off at once to replace each drum individually in one shutdown.
The drum structure on top was so massively heavy, it required a crane, a very big crane.
The morning's task is to install the main boom onto the superstructure of the crane.
This is the largest crane we ever brought to Southern California.
It has a capacity to lift over 3 million pounds.
The boom on this crane is 400 foot tall. It actually came in by rail, about 70 rail cars. It took about 4 weeks to assemble the crane. The cutting deck and derrick structure weighs over 1 million pounds. There have been heavier lifts than this and larger lifts than this, but this is a pretty rare combination of physical size and weight.
When you're lifting these kind of weights, there's no room for error.
Y'all ready tonight? Yeah. Doing this job as safe as you can possibly do. Thank you.
We actually lifted it sort of like a ballet. It came up, came off exactly as planned, almost pirouetted into a position set on the frame.
The
spent the next 3 weeks working around the clock, day and night, removing one coal trunk at a time.
What made the project so complex is the drums have been operating for over 40 years, and they weren't in the perfect shape as the new drums going in, and we wanted to do an incident injury. After we removed the existing coal drums, the next step was to install the new ones. It's very challenging when you think about swinging almost 300 tons, over 300 foot in the air, and lowering it in where you have about 2.5 inches to play with. And then we had to reattach the coke drum barracks to the top of the structure.
Knowing how much of our life we put in this, watching it fly, it was an experience of a lifetime.
I could hear people really clapping their hands and cheering, and you would think that the space shuttle was landing.
Wow.
This project is part of a significant number of ongoing investments to ensure the refinery continues to operate reliably, efficiently, and environmentally responsibly.
It's quite amazing that we see it completed.
I'm very proud of what this team and what the refinery accomplished. A lot of people have exhibited just great creativity, talent, passion, and energy to take a project that typically in our industry is very challenging, high-risk tasks, and to do it incident and injury-free. And to me, that's what operational excellence is about.
From the start of this project almost 4 years ago, it's been about the teamwork, the engagement of the communities, the unique character of all the personalities that came together to make the project successful. And with that, we've helped secure an important energy resource in Southern California for many decades to come.
Question?
Sure.
I have to imagine that part of engineering is a cost, logistic, and contingency analysis. And it boggles my mind, I guess it had to have been cheaper to do what you did instead of assembling pieces, which would have been a lot easier to transport, in place. Is that?
Very true, because as you saw when it was built back in, what, 1968, they were building it in place.
Right. But it was cheaper to ship it all the way from Spain, drag it down the street.
Move the light poles, move the street signs.
Yeah, okay.
What happens also with these type of drums, coke drums, they're not built everywhere. There's only specific fabricators, and one of the fabricators is in Spain. So
okay.
Any type of vessel like this they call coke drums are basically manufactured in Spain.
Okay.
So they don't. And it's also safer too because you're in a controlled environment. So you don't have to worry about weather, things like that once it's enclosed.
And it's cheaper too, right? Cheaper than having field work.
Nobody does, hardly anyone does field work anymore. Major things like this anymore?
I mean, we looked into it. I actually was involved in the early stages of this project. We did look into the option of, is there another way? Like I said, it's not in the most pristine shape as when it's brand new. What happens is because it gets hot, it gets cold, it gets hot, it gets cold. So this is where they start having problems with the material.
Sure.
And they have continually repaired it and repaired it and repaired it. That's what I said. It got to the point where it was time to not repair it and to make the investment.
Could you describe again what a coke drum does?
So it basically receives like heavy crude.
Come again?
Heavy crude. So you have crude that's like heavier carbons and lighter carbons, and so what it does is it cuts it so that it can split out the lighter ends and then the heavier ends, so you'll have actual coke dust and whatnot that is used for other products, but then you have the lighter stuff that can then be processed in other units that will then be used to produce gasolines.
So
different types of oils.
It's a fractional distillation container, somewhat, more or less,
but not as complicated as a distillation system that has trays inside, because you still have to crack this thing, what they call cracking the crude.
So it has to get very, very hot, is it?
Yes, very, very hot.
Where's the heating element? Yes.
On the material?
In the
So in there, it's just like a drum. So then you also have a separate heater.
In there?
No, not inside. Off to the side.
So the crate's heated up outside of that, and the product ends up in
there. And then you have special valves that have to cut it because it's so heavy. It's like a powder.
I got a question also. About 3 months ago, too, we had a career day, and I hosted the iron workers. And I was astonished. A journeyman iron worker starts at $36 an hour, that's $72,000 a year. Do the engineers beat that? A young engineer?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
What does an engineer make at Fluor, your first year mechanical engineer? Ballpark.
It's probably a little bit less than that journeyman.
Yeah.
Okay.
But better benefits. Maybe not.
A little safer.
Non-engineering curiosity.
Okay.
Well, what did that whole project cost about?
I do not remember the price tag on that one.
You may not want to remember.
Not even within a power of 10?
Nope. I actually love the project because they actually bought the drums, that's why.
But we have projects that can range from what they call mega projects that can run $3 billion, some as small as $1 million, depending on the service. If they just want engineering services or they want EPC, it just really depends. So we have a whole gamut of projects, depending on what the client wants.
But this one that took, what, I think they said 2 or 3 years?
4 years.
4 years? I mean, it would have been a larger price one, right?
So it was a larger price one, but the scope was really limited to the drums and the structural steel, so it wasn't like we were building an entire unit.
What'd you do with the old drums?
They removed them, and I believe they cut them up to sell them for scrap.
Nice.
Do these kind of projects affect like the price of gas in the paint, or is that totally separate?
Well, this is my opinion. I think it's separate. I mean, in California, we're fairly lucky in the sense that in the basin, although a lot of folks complain about the refineries, people drive their cars. So most of our gasoline comes locally. And then you have the change in formulation of gasoline. So you always see kind of a spike, like around a springtime or so, because they have to change the type of gasoline that's being used because of the warmer weather. And then also if there's maintenance that's being done, because you have to maintain these refineries, right? So when there's maintenance, maybe there's not enough product at the time.
In the interest of time, when I give them 5 minutes to finish up, otherwise we could keep going.
You know, because we have so many questions, can we show the one fun video?
Sure.
I want to show the fun side of engineering. It's not all just refineries. This is the fun video. Okay, this is actually a fun side of engineering. Competition can construction, where you actually build structures out of food cans, and then the cans all get donated to the food bank.
So they're at South Coast Plaza.
Yeah.
So
they,
okay.
Yeah.
Volunteer project. They don't get paid to do this. Everyone does this on their own time.
What's it called again?
Construction.
So So there's a theme, and then, you know, companies who participate build based on that, build around that theme.
Actually built this in our office to see if we have to make any modifications before the actual build night. The build night is after South Coast Plaza closes, typically the Friday before Labor Day weekend. And we have to encourage our families to bring their children to come join us.
Is it just the cans and the wood? Can they? Is there no adhesive or glue or hold it together?
Maybe some tape. That's about it. And a little bit of fishing line.
So the cans aren't attached. They're just stacked.
The very first year I actually participated in this competition, it was probably 2 or 3 in the morning. We're still working on our structure, and I hear someone's structure collapse. And they come back and fix it.
No. Competitions, so there's a competition between employees of different departments.
Different companies.
Different companies.
Oh.
Yeah.
So what's the arms? How do they extend if they're just snapped?
They're cans, and I think it's rebar, but it's a fishing line.
Tied to the arms. Oh, it's just, yeah, so they're the other way.
And we had them resting on the boxes and things like that.
About 3,013.
Did you win?
That year we actually won, I can't remember which one, they'll tell you, I don't remember. We won People's Choice by one vote, I remember that.
A win is a win.
Oh, best meal.
Best meal.
Because it's also like what type of food you bring. Is it healthier? Do you use more
fish, structural ingenuity, best use of the tables, have been solved.
And you didn't get sued on that.
Thank you.